Good morning. Before the lecture today, I want to add 2 points to yesterday's discussion. Somebody asked, where is he? Okay, somebody asked about the divergences in Qx, Q0. So I want to make it, if it's possible, a bit clear. So if you have Qx and Q0 in a given regularization, okay? Then you know that if X is much larger than in this the inverse of the cutoff, so in this case is the lattice spacing, then you know that this quantity here roughly goes like X to the 8th power, okay? Because of quantum number. But now when you do the integral, actually you are integrating up to the distances which are up to the lattice spacing when you sum on the lattice. Okay, so you integrate up to scales which arrive to the cutoff scale. And now if you want to integrate, and then this quantity here, it goes like 1 over x to the 8, in general is not integrable. Okay, so if you want to make it integrable, then to do this is what you read ever in the books. Then you have to add the so-called contact terms. In this case, it will be of this form. Okay. And now this is a box of a delta, so it's in Fourier basis is p square. Okay, and this is p. Sorry, p to the f Yeah, this is p to the fourth, and this is p square. And now, just for the naive regularization, if we stay on the lattice and we use the naive discretization of this, then we know that C1, that is the one we are interested in, is proportional to 1 over the lattice spacing to the fourth, to the cutoff to the fourth. Okay? Now, you can predict that this is divergent like this by looking at the divergence here, because here we need to do the d4x, the integral. This is already dimension 4, so you need another dimension 4. If you do the integral of this guy d4x, this diverge like 1 over a to the fourth, like this. Okay, so the fact that it diverge this way, the coefficient, you predict from the operator product expansion. What you cannot predict from the operator product expansion is what is the value. Okay, here there will be some, I don't know, d1, okay, some coefficient in front, and that you cannot predict by the operator product expansion, because it's not a universal property of this correlation function. This depends how you cut off the integral in your regularization. Okay, now so this you can write. Now let's write like q of x, Q of 0, let's put an I here, integrable. Okay, so now if you do the integral of the left hand side and the integral of the right hand side, this is finite, provided that you have chosen C1, C2, and C3 so that they diverge this way for C1, but then they make finite all the integral of this quantity. Okay, but then this means that, okay, let's remove I here. Put I here and minus here, okay? But then this means that the original correlator, okay, you can write as something that you can integrate plus something which diverge, like I was saying before. Now, the word identities that we use is quite general, okay, tells you that this coefficient C1 is equal to 0 in the case of Gisbert-Wilson relation, or in Gisbert-Wilson fermions, okay? So it's true that in any regularization this goes like 1 over x to the 8. So it tells you that in general the divergence should follow that power here. But then you can have word identity symmetries or that makes this coefficient being equal to 0. And this is what makes this integrable with Gisbert-Wilson and not with a naive discretization. It's clear. I think you were there. Yeah. Okay. Then as the second comment on yesterday was, I forgot, maybe one of the biggest statistics now on the lattice. There are a lot of models on which I'm not an expert, which are called compositics models or Technicolor models and so on. Okay, and of course, even this signal gamma gamma at LHC is interpreted sometimes with these models. And of course, all the techniques that you use here, like for instance, data prime, that is. Or the spontaneous symmetry breaking, all these techniques are currently used in studying these models. Okay, so I would say the community, I think, is to do this computation takes several years. Okay, and it's not something that you say today I try a model and tomorrow I try another model, because you have to plan. It's more or less like an experiment. You have to plan in advance and do so. I would say the community is studying a lot, but is somehow waiting to the experiments to have an hint of what to look for, okay, or what to study, okay. But it's clear that if the X is a composite particles, like let's say a sort of pion or a scalar 0++, the last is the tool to study it properly as a composite particle. Okay. A lecture that is more it's more what I said in the previous lecture is something that was, let's say, studying over the last 10 or 15 years, while the lecture of today is something that is happening now. Okay, I wanted to put something that is very recent, so you will see that it's theoretically it's still not complete, and also maybe it's not as clean as the previous arguments. Okay, but I wanted to give a flavor of what we are doing now. So the topic of today is the energy momentum tensor, how to define a non-perturbative an energy momentum tensor on the lattice. And this is, I think, I don't need to justify why this is interesting, but anyway, for the study of the energy momentum tensor on the lattice is not easy. It's not easy because what you have in the continuum usually is the conservation of it. So it's a worded entity like this, where O is an operator and X is different from zero. Okay? And then from this worded entity here, you derive the conservation of the energy momentum tensor. In particular, it doesn't renormalize and so on. Now, if you see how you get this worded entity here, you do translations, continuous translation, that is a symmetry of the continuum theory, and then you get the worded entity. On the lattice, you don't have continuum translation. You have discrete translation at most. Okay? And then the worded entity is not valid anymore. And therefore, T mu nu, it is not true that T mu nu doesn't renormalize. T mu nu gets a renormalization exactly like another operator. Okay? And so a non-perturbative definition of T mu nu is its bare definition, or let's call it T mu nu, which is like you do in the continuum. But then you have to complement the series of renormalization constant. We will see what they mean this, okay? Which then define really what is T mu nu on the lattice. Okay, so it's not enough just to give the formula. It's interesting for various reasons. Okay, first of all, if you want to know the equation of state of QCD or of QCD even in finite density, if you see now the equation of states at mu equals zero as a function of T, okay, let's say for instance the pressure, okay, then what we get here are data that they arrive around 500 MeV. Okay, well, we would like to know the equation of states in its whole range, and perturbation theory is very slowly converging. We expect perturbation theory to converge around 100 GeV or so. Okay, so we would like actually to know the equation of state in its entire range of temperature. Then it's useful theoretically because we want to know a tensor, and it's useful, I think, also phenomenologically, if you want to know for instance, the momentum distribution in an hadron, is something that is interesting to look at. And at the moment, on the lattice, we cannot do non-perturbative. Okay, the history of this, the history, At least the first good paper that I know is a paper due to, well, that make a substantial contribution to it. Are a series of paper of Caracciolo, Pellissetti, Menotti, and Curci, and this dates back to 89 up to 92, and here in Pisa. And what they did is they proposed to use a lattice version of the continuum word identity to determine this non-perturbative normalization constant. Okay. Now, what they proposed, and then they work it out also, of course, this you can compute in perturbation theory, because these are a normalization constant. A normalization constant you can compute in perturbation. They take contribution from the ultraviolet, so you can compute in perturbation theory. They did it at one loop in perturbation theory, and then they proposed even a method with the word identity to define non-perturbative energy momentum tensor. But what they proposed, I mean, it never worked out. But the step further that they did is that, first of all, to say use this, and second, what they computed the one loop constant, which are interesting when you want to check, for instance, your non-perturbative computation. Okay, so today what I want to show you is that actually using ideas similar to what, or analogous to what we use for chiral, for the chiral symmetry, there is a way to renormalize, to define non-perturbative energy momentum tensor on the lattice. And today we will always stick on the SU3, SUN, I mean, but Young and Mills. What I will show to you applies also with fermions, but in all the formulas in the details are still not derived. So, okay, what we did with the chiral symmetry, for instance, for the singlet, what we said is that. What we said is the following. We said we have a theory which, for instance, has a dependence. And then if we don't break softly, the mass is often called a soft breaking because the operator is dimension 3. And because the renormalization pattern is not heavily affected by the presence of the mass here. So what we did here, it's okay, we have a theory without the mass, we have a theory with exact chiral symmetry, the non-singlet one, or the singlet one is just anomalous. And what we did here, we introduce a soft breaking in the theory, a mass of the quark, okay? And then we said we made a chiral transformation, and we say that the theta dependence in the free energy can be rotated as a phase dependent, as the phase of the soft breaking term, okay? So somehow the introduction of a breaking, an explicit breaking on the symmetry, was useful to put the theta term on this side, and then we derive with respect to theta, and then here, if you derive with respect to theta, we got Q, and we didn't know what to do with QQ. But here, thanks to the breaking of the symmetry, we derive something that was M squared divided NF squared P00, plus the term of the condensate. And now with this part here, we knew what to do. Okay, and we demonstrated that actually this quantity was finite. Okay, so the introduction on the soft breaking term was instrumental to rewrite, so breaking the symmetry was better than not breaking, was instrumental to rewrite this quantity here this way, and then to show that all this quantity is finite. Okay, now we will try to make the same for the energy momentum tensor, and see where we can arrive. Now, to break the energy momentum tensor in a soft way, a natural way to do it is not to introduce a new local term in the action or in the Lagrangian, but is to introduce the temperature, because it's clear that if you think in the Euclidean and introduce a temperature, so I'll not the length in the temporal direction is equal to 1 minus the temperature. Sometimes I will call this also beta today, which has nothing to do with the beta of 6 over g naught square. When you introduce Euclidean, in the Euclidean, the Lorentz group, the Euclidean is SU4. But then if you say that one of the dimension of box is finite, okay, then you break SU4 to the standard cubic rotations, okay? And so we will see now that the temperature may play a role similar to the mass of the quark here, okay? And now we will see immediately what is the role, which parameter plays the role here, okay? So the goal is, sorry that I repeat this, but the goal is to do exactly what we did here, but now with a soft breaking that is the temperature, not anymore the quark mass. Okay, so I need some standard notation. So, okay, in the continuum, okay, the word identity, usually you define translation this way, and then for a scalar field, for instance, transform like phi of x, phi prime of x prime transform like phi of x. And now if you do the transformation delta phi, you define a phi minus phi prime, or phi prime minus, it's okay. Then delta s in the continuum is equal to 0, which, as I was saying before, this means that d mu t mu nu of x of a given operator is equal to 0 for x from 0. And t mu nu is defined energy momentum tensor. So if I now with the bar, I always define the d3x of t mu nu of x. So this is a function of x naught. And okay, now if you take into account the Minkowski Euclidean I, you have to be careful with the I, you see that the average value in the Euclidean of t naught, t 0 0 is equal to minus the energy of the system. Now, if you take T11 bar, is the pressure of the system times the volume. And then if you take now the momentum operator in Minkowski, this goes minus I T bar 0 I. So in particular, if you want to know PI, PI, then this goes like minus t bar 0 i t 0 i bar. Okay? Now, today there will be an abuse of notation. When I define an operator, an expectation value, here I mean the thermal average, okay, like this. I will define now what it means, which is equal to the path integral average. Which is the symbols are the same. Okay, this is the path integral average, this is the thermal average for that operator. Now there is a symmetry. We saw that QCD in the massless case, or even Young-Mills theory in the massless case, is scale invariant at the classical level. So if you take x prime that goes in lambda x, and then you take your field phi prime x prime that goes in lambda d, where d is the canonical dimension of the field phi x prime. Okay, the theory is invariant because there are no dimension-full coupling in the action is invariant. And then this means that there is a current which you can write with t mu nu x nu, the dilatation current, and which is conserved. So d mu mu is equal to t mu mu, okay, which at the classical level is equal to 0. Okay, so what is interesting is not only the energy, the pressure, or the momenta, but it's also the trace. Because this is signaling to you if the theory at some point at the quantum level is invariant under scale transformation or not. Okay. And the SU3 Young-Mills theory, even QCD, this is an anomaly in the sense that at the classical level T mu is equal to zero, but then when you do you go through the renormalization part, this is not anymore equal to zero. Okay. There are questions? Okay, since we will use the terminal theory just as a tool, we will not do any phenomenology of it or any. So, but as a tool, I need some just standard book definition. So, the partition, so L naught is the inverse of temperature at the moment. So, this is equal to trace. So the partition function is defined like e to the minus L naught h, okay? And, okay, the free energy is like was defined before, so f, the free energy density I will call with small f, is equal 1 divided L naught volume, the logarithm of z of L naught. Then there is the energy density, which is defined like minus 1 over the volume d over dl naught log of z of l naught. Okay, this is trivial. This is also because you derive with respect to l naught and you bring down an h. And then it's also useful to have the entropy density. So the entropy density is defined like minus l naught square divided the volume times the derivative with respect to L naught of 1 over L naught log of Z of L0. And now if you go in the thermodynamic limit where, and today we will be always in the thermodynamic, I will show formula with finite V, but then the results will also be valid when we send the volume, the special volume to infinity. And now in this case we have that the pressure is also equal to the minus the free energy. And now if you use the formula I gave you, also the entropy density and the one before, the entropy density is L naught times energy density plus pressure. And also one can write S as minus L naught square derived with respect to the L naught of P. Or if you like that, the entropy density, the derivative with respect to L naught, the L naught d over d L naught is also equal minus T over dt, where T is the temperature. Okay, so this is nothing else that the entropy density is the derivative of the pressure with respect to the temperature, something that you know very well. Okay, now how we formalize it in the path integral, as usual. So you see from here how we can formalize. This is just the transfer matrix of a quantum theory with length, with Hamiltonian H, and with length in the temporal direction equal the inverse of the temperature. So what is done? You take your X naught direction, and this is the special direction. Okay? And what you do, you define a path integral which is the standard path integral, but with a temporal direction which is the inverse of the temperature, so L naught 1 over T, okay? So if you have your path integral and you impose periodic boundary condition for bosons or antiperiodic for fermions, that is your final temperature partition function, okay? So now, it will be useful. So if you have your field phi x, then you will have, I see that you have to have periodic boundary condition in the temperature direction. So it will be useful to introduce P B C of M. Okay, where M is a vector of integers, so it's Z4, okay? So now this matrix here, it's the periodicity matrix, and in this case will be just L0, L1, L2, L3. Okay? So what is telling you this matrix? Here, if there is just the diagonal term, it's telling you that you have periodic boundary condition in time. Here in space in the three direction. I mean, it's a very baroque way to say that we have periodic boundary condition in all directions. But now we will see that it is this matrix here that plays the role of the mass in the chiral in the chiral argument. So it's this mass that will undergo a spurionic transformation in our free energy. So at the moment it's just a baroque way to say that we have periodic boundary condition. So now if you use all this definition here, and let's write here, and you have scale invariance in your theory, then you would expect that the free energy density is a number times temperature to the 4th power, just by dimensionality. You have only one scale there, that is temperature. It's an external scale, while in the theory there are no, the theory is scale invariant. And, but then also you, if you use this formula here, then you will get also that the energy density is minus 3C divided 1 over L to the 4th. Okay? And in fact now, if you do T mu mu, which would be minus E plus 3P, T mu mu Euclidean, and you use this here, you see that is equal to 0. Okay? So that if you have exact scale invariance in your theory, the trace is equal to 0 at finite temperature. Question? Okay. Now, let's introduce a new path integral, and it's defined like this, a new partition function, which is defined like trace of e to the minus L naught h minus I psi, where psi are real numbers, times the operator p, like this, okay? So, in 5 minutes you will understand why introduced, where it comes from this. But what it does this, okay, in the operator formalism, what it does is that it takes the all the states that you have here, and then it multiply the states at non-zero momentum by a phase, which is the momentum time, the total momentum times psi. Okay. Okay. If we write it in the path integral formalism, you see what it does here. When you derive the path integral, you insert, you know, for every time slice, you insert the identity as a sum over all the states, and if you put this shift all at the end, what it does that term here, it tells you that you are imposing not periodic boundary condition in the time direction, but you are imposing periodic boundary condition up to a shift in the spatial direction, the shift z, which is L naught times psi. Okay? So what this does with respect to the standard case is that now your phi of x naught plus L naught, okay, will be phi of x naught minus L naught psi. Sorry. I did it the wrong way. X is phi of x naught x if I put here minus psi. Okay, so you see that when you go So in space, you are still periodic boundary condition, but in time, you have periodic boundary condition up to a shift in the orthogonal direction, in the space direction. Okay? So this is how you write this, because you see, this is the generator of translation. So on the last state, translate the last state by this amount. So now if you do this, then you can write this in a more general form like that. And if you do like that, what you have here, you have to put some L naught psi 1, L naught psi 2, and L naught psi 3, and then here you have all the zeros again. Okay? So now this is not called anymore periodic boundary condition, we call it shifted boundary conditions. Okay. Now why this is useful? Now then we can define again the free energy as usual, minus log of z. And now if you do that, now the claim is the following, is that the free energy with temporal length L naught and shift psi, okay, is equal to free energy of L naught 1 plus psi square and shift. Okay? So today, just in 5 minutes, we will show this formula here. So you already see from here that it's very similar to what we had for the chiral anomaly. Okay? So what you do here, okay, what does the temperature? The temperature in the Lorentz group breaks the boost transformation, the rotation between spatial direction and temporal direction. Okay? So now what we have done here by inserting this shift, okay, is to tilt the system between space and time. You see, we tilt like this, okay? By introducing a shift psi, so we introduce an angle which is related to psi, okay? We rotate it by an angle with respect to the standard temporal direction. But at the same time, we have a soft breaking of the boost that was L naught. And the dependence on the rotation and on the soft breaking is not a generic one. You remember in the chiral symmetry case, it was not a generic one. It was e to the I theta m. Okay? And here is the same. The dependence on the soft breaking, the temperature, and the rotation shift is only through this invariant combination. Okay? And now, first of all, we will derive this formula here. But then you see immediately from here. Now, if you derive with respect to psi, you bring down a momenta. If you derive with respect to L naught, you bring down an Hamiltonian and a momenta. Okay? And therefore, you see that there are worded entities going around, exactly like what happened in the case of the chiral symmetry. Okay? Question? Okay, so let's try to derive this formula here. Okay. So what we did in the case of the chiral anomaly, we introduced a theta term, and then we did a chiral rotation that heated back the theta term. Okay, that was the epsilon 0a was minus theta divided by 2. Okay. So here we do exactly the same. We have to first of all to identify what is the equivalent of the mass, and the equivalent of the mass is v, and then we have to boost back this rotation that we did here. Okay. So let's make the following change of variable in our path integral. And the measure remains invariant. So we make just an SO4 a Euclidean Lorentz transformation like this. And then here the field in general can transform. If it's a scalar, this is just the identity. But in general, can transform with an irreducible representation of the Lorentz group, of the SO4 group. But we know that the measure is invariant. Okay, here there is no anomaly. Now, when you do that and you write your action, your partition function with the path integral, If you do such a transformation, you know that the form of the action will not change because the action is Lorentz invariant. The measure will not change. What will change is that in the action you integrate, the volume is infinite, but you integrate up to a certain time distance. And what you have to change is the stream of integration in your integral that define the action, okay? And these amounts, this amount, you can prove, it's easy to just to change V in V prime. And V prime is defined like lambda shifted boundary condition, okay? So if you do this transformation, everything remains unchanged, except the periodicity matrix, that change, okay? So you see the role again of the mass in the case of chiral symmetry is now played by the periodicity matrix. Okay, let's do a Euclidean boost and see what happens. So the Euclidean boost that undo this rotation, it's gamma 1 psi 1 minus gamma 1 psi 1 gamma 1 1 1 and all zeros, where gamma 1 is defined like 1 over 1 plus psi 1 square. Okay. So now if we do now if you take this, apply on that matrix there, and I didn't do mistakes. Let's simplify the life. We can take psi 2 equal psi 3 equal to 0. For demonstration, because at the end we will get a formula with only psi 1 square, but then we use the cubic symmetry of the problem and we generalize the formula. So just for simplicity, let's take that. Now if you do that, so you take this matrix here, you apply to this matrix without this extra term here, what you get is that the new periodicity matrix is L0 divided gamma 1, L1 gamma 1 psi 1, L1 gamma 1, and then there is 1, 1, 0, 0. Okay? Now, you see that this, I can reinterpret now this partition function, imagine the path integral associated to this and its partition. Now, I can interpret this direction as the temperature, and this as space direction, and space direction. Why not? At least mathematically I can do that. So I can rewrite the original path integral. So the path integral with V as BC is equal to the path integral with V prime as BC, which is this, which I can rewrite as trace of e to the minus L1 gamma 1 of a given, now, h tilde plus I psi 1 p 0 tilde. So I forget that this particular matrix comes from a rotation. I say this is just a thermal system. I interpret the temperature this direction. Of course, h will be different from the original one because now the temperature is direction 1. For instance, direction 0 is much shorter than the other. So the Hamiltonian will be different. And this will be the momentum in direction 0 if you interpret the temperature to be direction 1. Okay, I just changed names to the... Now, and what I know from before, is z of L naught psi is nothing else than z of shifted boundary condition, which is equal to these ones. Now, since the theory is translational invariant, the shift preserves translational invariance, and we are in the continuum here, and since the vacuum is translational invariant, you see that when L1 goes to infinity, to very large, very small temperature in this direction, the vacuum is invariant under translation, and therefore, this quantity is independent on the value of this element of the periodicity matrix. okay? Because this element here is nothing else than this one, L1 gamma 1 psi 1. But when L1 goes to infinity, I can just replace 0 to this, because the partition function is dominated by the vacuum, and the vacuum is translational invariant. Okay? So this is equal, in the limit where L1 goes to infinity, okay, to z of v second shifted boundary condition, where now v second, it's this one, but with a zero here. Okay? Now we have done. Because now what you get here, you see, is the standard periodicity matrix without any shift, but with direction L0, which is divided by gamma 1, L1 by multiplied by gamma 1, and the rest is wrong. And the rest is L2 and L3. Okay. So this means, now, if we assume to send everything L1 and L2 and L3 all to infinity, okay, so what you can prove here is that in the limit where the volume goes to infinity, the original free energy associated to the original partition function, F of L0 psi, this quantity here has to be equal to the free energy, okay, of something that has no shift, and as the L0 is replaced by L0 square root of 1 plus psi square. And there is no shift. Okay? So you see, apart from what we are going to use this relation I think is rather interesting, because usually we learn thermal field theory already at the, let's say, at the non-relativistic level, and then we use essentially the same formalism to go to add for relativistic theories. But in the relativistic theory, there are the boost generators that usually we never use to classify the states, because these boosts don't commute with the Hamiltonian, okay? But actually they are there, and this is telling you that you can formalize a finite temperature theory in the Euclidean, not only with the standard periodic boundary condition, but you have 1 degree of freedom more, okay? Well, you have 3 degree of freedom more, okay? So you can formalize a thermal theory with periodic boundary condition up to a shift, okay? If the theory is relativistic invariant, the formalization is exactly the same. And this, you see, the idea behind is essentially the same as chiral theory, okay, with theta in the mass term. Okay, is this something unexpected? It's not unexpected, of course. If you open the Landau, well, there is a paragraph where it talks about relativistic thermodynamics, and you see that, and I don't know why, but he was interested in writing the partition function of a thermal system at rest, but from a frame that was moving with respect to the thermal system. Okay, so you have some odd stuff here. You move and you say, how I describe that system in my reference system. And then if you do that, you will see that what you get is H minus V. You have to transform the Hamiltonian in the moving system. V is the velocity of the moving system, reference frame. And this is the partition function that you get, where H and P are the Hamiltonian and the momentum in the reference frame that is moving with respect to the rest frame of the system. And now, since we are in the Euclidean, what you do here, you say V is I psi, we take a complexified velocity, and you get the partition function that I was describing before. Okay, so this is nothing else. This is nothing else than the partition function of a system expressed in a moving frame, and then you are in the Euclidean, so you have to complexify the velocity. Okay, because you okay. Okay, so essentially this formula was known. I mean, now not in exactly in this form, but is so now. So now let's use this formula now to derive the word identity exactly like we did for the chiral symmetry. Now we know the machinery. We have to derive with respect to psi, and we have to derive with respect to L naught. So I just rewrite here so that we have, this is L naught VF is equal trace of e to the minus L naught H minus I psi dot P. Okay? And we remember that F of L naught psi is equal to F of L naught 1 plus psi square 0. And I will also call beta the temperature L naught psi square. And here I put a vector psi square. Before we put just psi 1 different from 0. But once you obtain this formula, since the system is rotate, the temperature doesn't break rotational invariance, you can just put a generic vector. Also, you see that with the shift, the temperature of the system is not anymore L naught, the length of the temporal direction, but actually is the length of this. You know, here there is L naught psi, the shift, and here there is L naught, and the temperature is the length of this vector here. Okay. Okay, let's start to derive with respect to psi. So let's start to derive now this one with respect to psi. And if you do that, you get that the derivative of the free energy with respect to psi I is minus I divided the volume times the expectation value of the total momentum of the system PI. And therefore, in particular, the second derivative of F with respect to xi, xi j, the generic one will be L0 divided by 2 pi pj. Now, if you use the, okay, I will do just, so if I now use this invariance here, I can write that the derivative f over d psi I, it's really the partial derivative, sorry. Even here is the partial derivative. Okay, so the derivative with respect to psi I of f, what is equal to the derivative with respect to beta of f, where beta I define, I'm deriving this part here now. Beta is this argument here. So it's the derivative with respect to beta times the derivative of beta with respect to psi I. Okay? And the derivative of beta with respect to xi from that expression is nothing else than L0 xi square root of 1 plus psi square. Okay? So now this means that we do 2 times the derivative with respect to xi. This is not, now if you take from here and then you put xi equal to 0, what you get is the following, is that the derivative with respect to xi square of f, computed in xi equals 0, so that I kill all the term proportional to, is nothing else than the derivative of f with respect to beta times L naught. Do the algebra, and you will see that is. Then, by putting together this and this, then you arrive to the final that pi PJ, I equal J, otherwise, so PI, PI, sorry, for Xi equals 0, there is no sum over I, it's equal to the derivative of the free energy computed at Xi equal to 0. Okay? Now, okay, this is something we need. Now, we can derive with respect to L-naught here, and not Xi. When we derive by L-naught, we bring down H and a P from there. So what we get is that, okay, if we do the derivative of df over dl naught at Xi equals 0 is 1 over L 0 V H computed at Xi equals 0, okay, it's always at Xi equals 0 in this case, minus 1 over L F computed at Xi equals 0. Okay. But now the invariant says that DF, that this quantity here has to be equal to df over d beta computed at Xi equal to 0. So at that I can say that this is equal to this, but this was equal to this. Sorry for the d, I have some errors in the. This was equal to this. So this quantity has to be equal to this quantity here. So at the end we get that pi, pi, is equal to 1 over L naught of Hamiltonian divided the volume minus the free energy all computed at Xi equals 0. Now if we put, if you remember that the Hamiltonian is minus T00, the free energy is minus the pressure, that is TII, and this we can write with T0A. At the end, the invariance here in the Euclidean can be written like L naught T bar 01 X naught T010, I use translational invariance, is equal to T00 minus T11, and this is at X naught different from 0. So you see that what we have get this way is a bordered entity which relates two insertion of the energy momentum tensor with the insertion of one component of the energy momentum tensor. Okay. And so this is the classical word identity that you use to show that there is no renormalization factor for T mu nu. The T mu nu is a rank 2 tensor in the continuum. And you can decompose, and you can decompose in T mu nu minus delta mu nu divided 4 T mu mu sum over mu. Sum over alpha T alpha alpha. So this is the symmetric traceless part, okay? And this guy, and then there is the trace part, okay? The singlet. Now this guy here, it's a gauge invariant operator with two indices symmetric and so on. There are no other operator with lower dimension in the theory, okay? We are in the Young-Mills theory. And then this means that can multiply, can renormalize just multiplicatively. Okay. T00 minus T11 has no trace component. It's just the traceless part of that tensor. So this guy T01 and T00 minus T11 belong to the same multiple, to the same nonet. Okay. And therefore they have to renormalize with the same Z. that the soft breaking never changed the randomization constants of the operator, okay? You can always choose randomization constants that are independent on the soft breaking parameters. But therefore, this means in particular that here, if there was a renormalization constant, this should have been z square of this operator, and here there should have been z of this operator. But then since this identity has to be true, z has to be equal to 1. Okay? So this means that in the continuum, z of t, let's call, has to be equal to 1. It's just a different way of looking at what we are used to with the energy momentum tensor. Okay? Now, there is another interesting relation here. What is this? If we see this from this point, this is nothing else that the... Okay, you have a thermal a system that is hot, and this system will have a total momentum you know, the total momentum of the system will be zero, but the fluctuation of this distribution will not be zero, okay? In particular, you will have a momentum variance, which is this one, okay? You have the fourth cumulant, the sixth cumulant of this. So in general, you will have a momentum distribution. And you will have an energy distribution for your system and the pressure. So now you see that here what we have related, apart the free energy here, which appears only in the first of the, in these equations, what we have related here is the momentum distribution of the theory to the energy distribution of the theory. Okay. Now you can play the game to do more of this derivative. You do the fourth derivative, the sixth, and so on. And what you get is a plethora of an infinite tower of ordered entity, which relates all the higher cumulants of the momentum distribution with the higher cumulants of the energy distribution. So in a relativistic theory, the distribution of energy and the distribution of momentum are related. And this, of course, was expected. Eh? Okay, like we are at zero temperature. Okay, there are questions? Okay. Since it's quite late, okay, I derive all this from the beginning to the end. Now, I just mentioned which are the other worded entities. There is another one that can be derived in a similar way. I write it here because we will... So this worded entity is telling that T0k, now with a shift that is different from zero, here the shift was always zero at the end. We derive, like with the theta term, we derive with respect to the shift, but then we put the shift equal to zero. Now in this case, I don't put the shift equal to zero. And you can prove that in presence of a shift, there is a relation that is 1 minus psi k square, T00 xi minus TKK xi. Okay, so this is in the continuum, you see, it's not interesting for normalization because it's the same number of operators here and there. We will see that will be useful on the lattice. Okay, there is another one for this. Okay, for the same, we will derive. Then there is another formula. If you remember from the formula I gave at the beginning, the entropy density was L naught square divided d over d with the minus d beta. Actually, it's like this, because there was 1 over L naught in the... Okay, now from what we said before, from what we said, that T0i with a shift is equal minus df over d beta times d beta over d xi. Okay, and d beta over d xi, we saw it's trivial. It's L naught xi 1 plus psi square. Okay? So now, is the same. With the shift, because with the shift everything becomes okay. So this now is equal to this, okay? And so what you, we can write at the end is that the entropy density S is minus L naught 1 plus psi square to power 3 half T0 I direction I divided XI. This is just a formula, but for we will see for the lattice this is extremely extremely important. The reason is because now T0 I, you know, if you have an operator like T00 or T11, the diagonal one, they can mix with identity. And so when we compute on the lattice, this quantity is a tragedy because there is a quartic divergent. T0i has non-trivial quantum number under Lorentz symmetry, okay? And so this has no divergences again. And so you can compute the entropy just by measuring the expectation value of this quantity. So this simplifies enormously the computation of the entropy. Just because the ultraviolet property of this operator are much simpler than the standard ones. Okay, just remember this formula that we will use. Okay, now okay, now we are left with the last word identity, that is the one for the trace anomaly. So we say that at the beginning that T mu mu, using the standard definition, is minus S over beta plus 4 times the pressure. This is the entropy density, so is E plus P times L naught. And now I call the temperature beta, the inverse temperature beta, because I have the shift. So this means, now if I want to do B over D beta over D beta T mu mu, this quantity will be 4 times beta, D over D beta the pressure, minus beta D over D beta of S divided the beta. So S times the temperature. Now, if you put together this derivative, it's trivial to show that this is equal to minus over beta cube d beta of beta cube times the entropy density. Okay. You make the gymnastic that I was doing before. You see, T mu mu, an operator that under Lorentz is invariant because it's a singlet. So T mu mu, exactly like the free energy, you can write as a function that is only a combination of L naught, not the free energy, as a function that is a combination of L naught times 1 plus psi square, exactly like the free energy. And now when you derive with respect to psi or derive with respect to L naught, you do exactly the same exercise that we did before. I mean, there is nothing different. So at the end of the story, you can replace d over d beta with the derivative with respect to psi, exactly like we did before. Okay, and then if you put all the factors together, it comes that the trace anomaly, psi, is equal to 1 plus psi square derivative with respect to psi k of 1 plus psi square cube t 0 k divided psi k. Okay, this is a useful identity. So you see what, remember that now the trace anomaly can mix with identity, and a part with identity can mix only with itself. So in general, the trace anomaly renormalized, like let's call it ZS times itself, this is the renormalized operator, minus the identity, and the identity you can write like this. So you subtract the expectation value at zero temperature for T mu mu. Okay. Now you see that here you derive with respect to Xi, which is equivalent to derive with respect to the temperature. So when you do, remember that Zs is in the randomization constant is independent on Xi, but when you derive with respect to the temperature, you are eliminating the subtraction due to the singlet, to do the identity here. Also this one is temperature dependent and you are making the derivative. Okay, so the derivative past Zs and this is temperature independent. So what you are left here is that at the renormalized level, this would tell you, this here would tell you that this would go like the singlet times Z kappa T mu mu equal. But then on this side, there is no singlet. There is just the other one, okay, T0k, and then there are some derivatives. But we just show that T0k here cannot renormalize. Okay, remember that Z again is Xi independent. So once you're shown here, then this doesn't renormalize. Okay. And so this proves that if this doesn't renormalize, also the trace doesn't renormalize. Okay. And so the trace anomaly in Young-Mills or even in QCD does not, in general, actually. Does not renormalize. We don't need to put any renormalization constant. Okay? So the operator that is renormalized is just the bare one in the continuum minus, I mean, the subtraction of the identity. Okay. Now, we will see in the slides the renormalization of the nonet. Okay? This has been done on the lattice. Now, this is going on. Two groups are doing. We are doing in Milan and they're doing in England. And it's still not completed this. So for this, I will show you what happens in dimensional regularization. Okay. Because the non-perturbative is still not done. And while for this, I will show you the non-perturbative results. So what happened? So I just catch it. Okay. I mean, the demonstration is a bit. So if you write in dimensional regularization the trace part of the energy momentum tensor, this is 2 epsilon, where epsilon is 4 minus d. It's, sorry, d is 4 minus 2 epsilon. Okay? And then you have to divide by d g naught square times f alpha beta a alpha beta a. Sum over alpha and beta. Okay. Now, okay. Now let's renormalize this operator as usual. As I said before, this operator gets a renormalization constant in front and a vacuum subtraction. Okay. And so this operator has the same quantum number of this, so it renormalizes in the same way. But we know now that the renormalization of this operator times the renormalization of the coupling that appear here, it must be 1, because at the end we know from that word identity that there is no normalization. Okay? So what we can do at the end, what we can write is that, let's call it FF renormalized. Okay? This is nothing else that in dimensional regularization is called ZE to the minus 1 for some, I don't know why, but FF minus FF zero temperature. And also G naught square in dimensional regularization goes like mu to the 2 epsilon G square ZG to the minus 1. Okay? There is a relation between this if you work in dimensional regularization perturbation theory, you can find a relation between Z, E, and Z, G. Okay. This relation can be shown in various ways. For instance, using shifted boundary condition. We did shifted boundary condition and using one loop perturbation theory. Anyway, what you can prove just by doing the computation is that the product of ZE times the renormalization of the coupling, G is the renormalized coupling, time epsilon, is nothing else in the limit where epsilon goes to zero, is epsilon minus the beta function of the theory divided by G. I mean, this is what it comes out, okay? So now, if we take now this definition here, we put inside here, so Z goes on this other side. What we get, let's put it here. What we get is that T mu mu minus the vacuum subtraction is nothing else that 2 epsilon Z G Z E divided D mu to the 2 epsilon divided G naught square FF renormalized. Okay? Now, what we do now is that we use epsilon ZG ZE. This is nothing else that in the limit epsilon goes to zero, there is no pole in 1 over epsilon down, so it's minus beta over G, and here D is 4. So at the end of the story, this becomes minus beta over 2 G cube. Okay? And this is called the trace anomaly equation, okay? And you know that the product of all these things, this is depend on G naught square, on G square, G cube, and all this has to be independent on the scale at which you renormalize your coupling, okay? Because this operator here doesn't get any renormalization, so has no anomalous dimension, it's just a constant in mu, okay? And so you see that we started with a theory that at the classical level was scale invariant. We end up with a theory which is not scale invariant because there is a beta here which is different from zero. Okay? Since we have the beta function that is different from zero, in particular the B0 here appear, in my normalization beta here start with G cube times minus B0 G cube. Since B0 is different from zero, then you get here, well, since beta is different from zero, then you get the anomaly. Questions? Okay, so now I will show. Okay, so now we have all this work that up to now we were always in the continuum. We just shifted the boundaries. Now we have to go on the lattice. As I said, on the lattice, the translational invariance is lost, but also at the regularized level, also the SO4 group is lost. And what is left is only what is called the hypercubic group. You can rotate by 90 degrees between the axis X and Y and so on. Okay. So the energy momentum tensor has 10 components. 9 form in the continuum the irreducible representation symmetric, 2 index symmetrics, and 1 is the trace. Now, on the lattice, you have to decompose this representation with in the hypercubic irreducible representation. The singlet remains a singlet. For historical reason, it's called T2. While the nonet gets transformed in a sextet, which are the off-diagonal component of this one, that are the off-diagonal component of the tensor. And then in a triplet, which are the 3 traceless component but diagonal. Okay, these are 2 irreducible representations of the hypercubic group, so you have to split them. And so you use exactly the same argument as I was showing before. And then, okay, usually one puts the renormalization of the first in front, and then, but this is just a convention. These are just the relative, these 3 renormalizations are all independent to each other, because these are 3 operators which are different irreducible representation under the hypercubic group, okay? But okay, usually one puts ZT in front, and then this is just the relative renormalization with respect to this, and this is the relative with respect to this, okay? And what we do now on the lattice, now F mu nu, as I said for the topology, one can define F mu nu like we did for the plaquette. One does something a bit more smart, some 4 plaquettes around these points. for q mu nu, and then takes the anti-symmetric part. And this is just the definition of f mu nu that one can use on the lattice. I would say is the naive definition. Okay, and then once you have this, you include this inside the formula here. So what you have here are all these traces of links, of plaquettes, sorry, that appear in the definition. Okay, now what you can do, you remember that I say that, okay, by starting from the argument t0kxi, it's nothing else than the derivative with respect to xi of this partition, the log of the partition function with a shift, and just trivial factor in front. So what you can do, you can discretize this derivative on the lattice, discrete shift you can do, and then you just, for this, you use the bare, so the point there is always the same. So what you do is that now this is at the continuum level, and now you say that at the lattice level, this will be zt times t0k1 bare. This is the bare operator, and this has to be equal to minus the derivative of the free energy with respect to the shift ck that you can compute on the lattice. Okay, you just compute the derivative of the free energy with respect to the shift that you do. And now if you bring that, now this you compute numerically, this you compute numerically, and then you bring this down, and this gives you the renormalization constant. Okay? And now the results are here, as a function of g naught square, so the coupling that you put, this is the renormalization constant, and this is, you see here, the red points are the results of the simulations. And then there is a fit, which is given here, the results of the fit. This is just a phenomenological fit, but with a coefficient chosen in such a way that the one loop result is reproduced. Okay? So now you see that why it's important to do it non-perturbatively, because now before the non-perturbative computation, the results of Caracciolo would give you the coefficient of g naught square, which is this black line here. Okay? And now you see that when we do simulation at finite temperature, usually I would say we are above 0.5, 0.6, something like this. Okay, in this. So we are in this region. So this is completely, so you would make an error of 10-15%. On the equation of states, you want an error of the percent. Okay, so if you don't know this, I mean, you cannot reach that precision. Now, why I derive this word identity? Because in the continuum it's not very useful, but on the lattice, this is typical. You see that the hypercubic group split the multiplets, and you have the diagonal part and the off-diagonal, and they are different irreducible representation. Now, this word identity in the continuum is not useful, but on the lattice relates, you see, the expectation value of two different irreducible representations, and therefore relates the renormalization constant of this guy with the renormalization constant of this guy, okay? And in particular, the relative one, again, you can remember, here you write as ZT capital T, and this is equal to Z capital T times ZT small, the relative one, and then you simplify Z capital T, and you get the ratio of this divided by this, it is just the relative renormalization of the triplet with respect to the sextet, okay? And again, you see here as a function of g naught square, these are the data that one generates, and this is the phenomenological fit. And again, if you take perturbation theory, the result is here, and is the black line. Here you see the constant is much smaller, so it's a bit better. I mean, this is an effect of maybe 6% at most. But still, perturbation theory, it doesn't work. And the fact that perturbation theory doesn't work is not typical of these particular operators. It's always like this on the lattice. I mean, this perturbation theory is very slowly convergent on the lattice. Okay. Yes. Here is empty because it's still not finished. But then, now, what we can do, here we know how this renormalizes, so we can use this word identity now. Since we know here, we compute this at the bare level, We compute this at the bare level, we do the ratio of the two, and then we compute, and then we compute the trace anomaly completely non-perturbative. And here there is a prediction, which is sharp, I mean, because it's the trace anomaly, which the first term, G naught square, has to go exactly with beta 0 divided by 2. So it's this coefficient here. And now here there is no ambiguity. This has to come like this, okay? There is not even a computation to be done. Okay, and then why we are doing all this? Because we would like to compute at the end the equation of state, like the entropy as a function of the temperature. In this case, it's for pure gauge, but then we would like to do for full QCT a much higher temperature than one can do, let's say, without using the energy momentum tensor. So this is the lattice spacing again. This is the entropy density normalized to 32 pi squared divided 45 is the, and the temperature cube is the Stefan Boltzmann. And then you see that what one does is compute at several lattice spacing, the points, and in this case we are particularly lucky, there are discretization effects are very small, and then you extrapolate to the continuum limit. Okay, and this is the result, this is preliminary. This is the results that you get. This now is the temperature divided the critical temperature. This theory has a critical temperature, the SU3-Young-Mills theory has a critical temperature of around 300 MeV. Okay? So here we are at around 6 GeV. And this is again the entropy divided the Stefan Boltzmann. You expect that goes to 1 in the ultraviolet. Here I show the data up to 20. Actually, now we have data up to 200 TC. So we can go in a factor 10 larger than this. But I think it's clear from here. You see what happened. I mean, near the transition is very, very, this is very, very sharp, the increasing of the entropy, and then goes very, very slowly to the Stefan Boltzmann value. Okay. There is a perturbative formula up to G not to the sixth. And the idea is that then to match at some point, roughly maybe a 100 GV or so, to match with the formula and then have a continuous function from zero temperature essentially to the infinite temperature. I mean, unfortunately, this perturbative formula converges very, very slowly. And you see also from here, I mean, the entropy density and in general all this, or even the pressure, they are very, very slow in varying with the temperature. I mean, once you remove the trivial factor T cube. Okay. So the summary. So I would say, apart all the technical stuff that I did, I think it's very interesting to notice that something that was noted already in the 60s could be very, very useful for the lattice, exactly like the chiral anomaly is useful in the chiral symmetry. So if you study the system in a boosted reference frame, or if you like, if you formalize a thermal system in the path integral, not in the standard way, but also with a shift, then you get a plethora of ordered entities at shift xi equals 0 or not equal 0, which are very, very interesting because they can use to simplify the computation, to renormalize the tensor, and to simplify the computation. And the idea that is behind this, I think, is very nice. Is usually, if this is space direction and this is temperature direction, usually we have 90 degrees between the space direction and the temperature direction. But if the theory is relativistic, the angle, the free energy is independent on the angle between the temperature direction and the space direction. And then you can play with the angle to design quantities which are easier, in our case, easier to be computed numerically. I mean, this is the idea which is behind this, okay? And then you have to check a lot of things, finite volume effect and so on, but everything goes through. I mean, there is no problem. So at the end, what you can get, this is the formula. Zt you get from the worded entity, and then what you get is a computation of the entropy density that is really straightforward. I mean, this computation is something like 10 or 100 times cheaper than what people used to do. I mean, in okay, so I want to do some final consideration since it's the last. So I started by saying that the lattice gauge theory is a phantoscope. Okay, so you have to think at it. Okay, we want to compute something that is physical, And we have the field theory. So now you cannot take what you would compute on paper and put on a computer, because this would be a disaster. This is why this field was stuck for many, many years. I mean, because this step was not done. I mean, now you have to think that you have to modify the probes of your theory. I hope I show you some example. You find probes which maybe analytically they are more complicated to be implemented, on piece of paper, but the computer can manage them much faster, okay? For instance, the low modes of the Dirac operator is something that is of this kind. I mean, if you have to do it analytically, you never end up. But for the computer, it's something that is very easy to be done. So you have to take what you want to compute, physical or not physical, and find something that is simple for this guy to be computed and not maybe for you, okay? Also, what I always stress is that it's interesting because the phantoscope is, we can play with it. And so we can look also at quantities that experiment cannot look at. And this is very interesting. For instance, the condensate anomaly contribution to the eta prime and so on. And of course, there are a lot of applications also for experimentalists, especially the flavor physics. For many, many years, lattice, the main part of the community, was driven by verifying the CKM mechanism. So the other point that is, let's say, by now become standard, thanks to the progress over the last 10 years, is that we can access the chiral regime of gauge theories. And this is, of QCD for instance, this is extremely interesting because in that corner of the theory, there are many things that happen and are non-trivial, okay? And I hope to convince you that there is a lot of progress, but this phantoscope is, if you will look at it in 20 years from now, you will see that it's still very, very crude, okay? Because for instance, the baryons, we cannot study well the baryons, and this is already something unacceptable. Or we cannot study finite density QCD, for instance. So what I want to say here is that we are driven by solving physics problems, but there are still technical. It's the first time that field theory is so difficult to solve numerically in history, and therefore we still have to develop in parallel with physics a lot of instruments, a lot of tools to solve it numerically. Thanks.